Hello. Good evening and welcome to ICERM. My name is Homer Walker. I'm one of the deputy directors here. ICERM is the Institute for Computational and Experimental Research in Mathematics. It's funded primarily by the National Science Foundation and affiliated with Brown Universities. ICERM's mission is to support, extend, and generally enrich the relationship between mathematics and computing. Tonight's program is one of our public lectures. We have several of these every year, and they're intended to highlight the very vital role that mathematics and computing play in issues of broad public interest and concern. I'm delighted, I take great personal pleasure in introducing tonight's speaker, whom I've known for many years and whose work I've admired for all those years. Chris Johnson is a distinguished professor of computer science at the University of Utah and founding director of the Institute for Scientific Computing and Imaging there. You'll note that the acronym SCI is pronounced SCI, which is appropriate for Utah. Chris has been known for many, many years, been recognized for many, many years as a leader in scientific computing and visualization. His leadership has been recognized with many, many awards and honors, too many to mention here. I'll refer you to the homepage, to the website for the SCI Institute to find out more about both the SCI Institute and about Chris's achievements. A longstanding particular interest that Chris has had is in scientific computing and visualization of biomedical data. This has always, of course, been a very important area, and it's been of increasing importance in recent years due to our mainly, I'd say, entering the era of big data. By that I mean just massive data sets, sometimes unimaginably large data sets. Obtaining information from these data sets, just because of their size and complexity, entails new challenges, but also offers increasingly many new opportunities. In this regard, data visualization holds special promise. If a picture is worth a thousand words, then a well-constructed image must surely provide more information than many millions of raw numbers. I'm very much looking forward to Chris's talk, as I'm sure you are, so please join me in welcoming him.
Thanks everyone for coming out this evening to listen a little bit about the work that we do at the SCI Institute. And so when I go around and give these talks, I like to tell people a little bit about how influential the University of Utah has been in creating computer graphics and in things that you use every day that you probably didn't even know about. So this is a collage of some of the people at Utah over the history who really helped create computer graphics. Up in number one is David Evans, who was brought out from Berkeley to start a computer science department back in 1965 at Utah. And the first person he hired was number two, who is Ivan Sutherland. And Ivan created the first interactive computer graphics system called Sketchpad. He would later win a Turing Award for that work. The third faculty member is number four, is Tom Stockham, who was a signal processing guy. Tom actually created the CD-ROM and many other things. And those three faculty members somehow convinced and brought together this amazing young talent that would go on to change our world in computer graphics. So number three up there is John Warnock. John got his PhD at Utah. He then co-created PostScript and then co-founded Adobe and has been the president of Adobe ever since. I am very fortunate to live in the Warnock Engineering Building, three floors of that. Number five there is Ed Catmull. Ed got his PhD at Utah and then co-founded Pixar. He's been currently the president of Pixar and also now of Disney Animation. Number six is Alan Kay. Alan created object-oriented languages. He won a Turing Award for that. He also co-created the laptop computer, which some of you may use. Number eight is Jim Clark. Jim got his PhD at Utah, then he became an assistant professor at Stanford, left Stanford to create Silicon Graphics Incorporated, SGI. Then he left that and he created Netscape, and then he sold that to AOL for $1 billion, and then he created WebMD, and then he created MyCFO, and now he's created CommandScape. He just was at Utah a little while ago to tell us about that. Number 10 is Nolan Bushnell. He got his bachelor's degree at Utah. Nolan created Pong, the first video game, and then Atari. He sold Atari for $200 million in the 1980s, and then he created Chuck E. Cheese Pizza Time Theaters, which have been very popular with the kids. Nolan tells the story about how he was the only boss of Steve Jobs, because Jobs and Wozniak worked for him at Atari, and he tells the story of when Steve Jobs came to him to try to get him to invest in this new company called Apple or something, and he didn't think they were going to make it, so he didn't invest. Anyway, some amazing people have come through, and we really have a rich tradition in visual computing. These are the amazing faculty of the Scientific Computing and Imaging Institute that I will tell and show some of their works in today's presentation. The Institute is pretty much equally partitioned into three different research cores, into scientific and information visualization, into biological, medical, and geophysical image analysis, and then in scientific and biomedical computing. And we have about 200 total people of faculty, staff, postdoc students, and so there's about 60 or 70 people in each of these different areas that will show up at our weekly seminars. So we have a really great critical mass in each of those areas, and that's really allowed us to do a lot of interesting work and a lot of interesting collaborations. Just to give you a sense of the breadth of the Institute, these are the national research centers that we direct, and a longstanding NIH Center for Integrative Biomedical Computing. That's the one I'll mostly talk about today, but Valerio Pascucci directs this DOE Center for Extreme Data Management Analysis and Visualization. We're also one of the NVIDIA GPU Centers of Excellence. We have a Center for Computational Earth Sciences, and then a new center, a DOD Center on Computationally Designed Efficient Materials. So you can see the breadth of what we do. We do a lot of work with industry as well, and you'll see combinations of biomedical companies and imaging companies and computer companies. Okay, let's get started. So one of the catchphrases these days is personalized medicine or precision medicine, and our NIH Center has been devoted to a piece of that for a number of years, and the part that we do is to use images to create computer models of patients and or their parts, or biologically subject-specific models, and then to do very accurate computer simulations of functional attributes on those models and then visualize the results. And so we start off with medical images, for example, a CT or MRI, functional images like EEG or fMRI, also biological imaging, which has really taken off lately, so things like electron microscopy, two-photon microscopy, confocal microscopy. We take those images and then we do image analysis, so we do the registration, the filtering, the segmentation, and from those images, we make the models, computer models of those patients or the biological subject-specific parts. And then the simulations are done, are application-dependent. It could be orthopedic implants, it could be finding the source of an epileptic seizure, could be new device physics testing, and we visualize everything, the images, the models, the simulation results, and then be good enough with all this to take it into the lab or the clinic and have it really be used. And then that's the part that takes many, many years of hard work by many people. And then under the hood is really the software that we create to instantiate all of our research into software that the different application areas can use. So I'll tell you some stories. First, we'll start off with Jeff Weiss. So Jeff is a bioengineer, computational bioengineer. He's also in the Department of Orthopedics at the University of Utah, and he studies articular cartilage, mostly in hip, but then also some in knee. And he uses computation to be able to better understand changes in the cartilage from the stresses of both daily life in normal people and people with arthritis. And the idea is that he uses this image-based modeling technique where he'll start off with a patient and take a CT scan for the images, and then he'll outline the bones of the hip and the cartilage using segmentation tools, and then build a large-scale computer model of these and do what are called finite element simulations in order to simulate the different pressures and stresses and then visualize those. So he's now gotten so good at this that we can basically, instead of doing one-size-fits-all types of hip replacements, we'll now be able to do, we have the technology now to be able to do individualized hip replacements if we had the right 3D printer. And those are coming online. They have to print titanium, so they have to be heavy-duty printers, but one of the studies that's going on now is to be able to use some shape analysis, which I'll talk about in a little bit, to be able to better characterize different populations of patients so that we can give them a better idea of what is the right hip replacement or what is the right knee replacement. I just had both of my knees replaced this last year by one size fits all off the shelf things, and I would have much preferred to have the personalized version of Jeff's technology, but that is coming. And so if you're young, you'll be able to use this when you need your new hip or your new knee. This is Rob McLeod, and Rob is a bioengineer, computational bioengineer, who studies electrophysiology mostly in the heart. And in this case, he's looking at implantable electrodes that go off automatically at the onset of a fibrillation. So hopefully you've only seen it on TV when someone has a heart attack and they go down on the ground and the emergency personnel come with the paddles and they say clear, and then the person jumps off the ground a bit. And on TV at least it seems like it takes about three times and either it works or it doesn't. What's happening is the heart during a fibrillation, it's beating out of rhythm. It's not being an efficient pump as it normally is, and so it's not pumping oxygen to your brain. If you don't get oxygen to your brain for about 3 minutes, you die. So you need to do this defibrillation as quickly as possible and to get it back into the normal beating rhythm. And what defibrillation is doing, it's really stopping the heart in hopes that it comes back on its normal rhythm. So it's like rebooting your laptop when it freezes, and you hope it comes back normally. Since it's such a small time from start of fibrillation to death, and it's why this particular disease is called sudden death, you do not want to catch sudden death, is that engineers and cardiologists have designed these implantable electrodes that will go off automatically at the onset of a cardiac fibrillation. So the trick now, though, is to figure out when they should go off and how much voltage they should give off and where do you place them to get the optimized defibrillation. So you want to use the minimum amount of energy to get the maximum effectiveness. And currently, the state of the art is pretty much an ad hoc one, where a cardiologist will look at you and say, you look like Bob from 3 weeks ago, and I think I put them in, around here. And it's a pattern matching game that they use, and the more they do, the better they get at it. Well, we're good enough now to be able to take images of patients, make computer models of those patients, do tens or hundreds of simulations to optimize the placement to give us the best efficacy for those defibrillation electrodes. And here are the first four patients that we did to prove this. So you have to prove this, you can do this to the cardiologist, and that's a good thing. And if you have to have this done, you'll find out that before they let you out of the hospital, they test the defibrillator to make sure it works. Fortunately, they will anesthetize you before they do this, because it does not feel good to have your heart shocked. And so we got permission to take and put electrodes. Here's a patient, and we have put measurement electrodes across the chest, and then they will do a test, and we do a quick x-ray scan so that we'll get the placement and location of where they had implanted that electrode. And so now we have a measurement, and we have a known location and a known amount of voltage, and then we can build a computer model and give it those same exact conditions and do a one-to-one comparison. And so what you see in this image is the measurements are on the left, the simulations are on the right, and we were within 10% error, the simulations versus the measurements, which is really good for applications in medicine. And so now, every day, the patients that are having this procedure done, they will come in and get a scan. There are technicians that will then build the computer models and then run the simulations, and then the results of those simulations are given to the cardiac surgeons for input on where they will place those electrodes. So it took us more than 10 years, I should say, to go from idea of wanting to be able to do this to being able to handle the complexity of modeling accurately enough the human body and its parts, and then also designing the software that was able to take those mathematical computational and do the computational results and visualize the results and then scale it up to a big enough, allow it to do enough complexity. So it's a long-term process, but we're now finally able to do this in a real way. This is another example of the cardiologist Nasir Marouche. So Nasir heads the Comprehensive Arrhythmia Research and Management Center at the University of Utah. Nasir specializes in atrial fibrillation ablation. So these are the small chambers of the heart. And when they're fibrillating, it's usually not life-threatening, but it can definitely cause significant quality of life issues. In the past, cardiologists have primarily given drugs to be able to control those arrhythmias. But recently, they have figured out that people that have long-term atrial fibrillation have a multifold increased risk of having stroke and significant stroke. So now they try to correct the arrhythmia. And one way to do that is by using a catheter. And what you'll see here is, so Nasir there, this is a real patient. He's looking at these 7 30-inch monitors, and that one in the bottom middle is ours that has the simulations on it, and he's taking a catheter up from the bottom of the leg and then guiding it in with some of our image guidance to be able to then get near the heart. And then from the images, the visualizations, and the simulations, we're showing him possible places of where he should ablate, which is giving a little electrical discharge, and that will actually kill cells, burn cells, and the idea is to disrupt the reentrant arrhythmia within the heart and the atria. And so if he gets those right, the person then, the atrial fibrillation ceases. So he has become so successful at this, so accurate, that people are flying in from all over the world to have their surgery done at Utah. And just a few months ago, a company has bought the technology to take this through FDA. So this will be, in however many years it takes to go through FDA, this will then hopefully be offered in the future to others. All right, let's go down to the biology. So here's a very famous image of Jim Watson and Francis Crick back in 1953 looking at their famous model of DNA, and which they are awarded the 62 Nobel Prize for that discovery with Maurice Wilkins. And what I think strikes it a bit, for me being a visualization researcher, is how many hours and months they spent manipulating this three-dimensional visual abstraction from experimental results and theoretical results until they were able to match it up and come up with the structure. And certainly if they had the technology of today's computer graphics and visualization, they would have been using it, and as do thousands of biologists all over the world, as an essential tool. What I also find interesting now in our new day of 3D printing is that they could also now 3D print this back out and look at it in 3D and play with it in 3D. So one of Jim Watson's graduate students is one of my colleagues at Utah, Mario Capecchi. And Mario won the 2007 Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine for figuring out how to knock out a gene in a mouse. This was done back in 1980s, and which really has changed our world. And this is one of the PR shots the University of Utah sends out to people about Mario, and it was taken in our visualization lab, which is great. And the image in back of Mario is actually the head of one of my former PhD students, Dave Weinstein. And so we kid Dave that Dave is the brain behind Mario, at least in this picture. So Dave's head and brain have become famous throughout the world. So a few years ago, Mario approached us about an imaging and visualization problem that he had. And it was about using images and visualization to try and get at the so-called phenotyping problem. So this is the idea of, we know we can knock out a gene and we can control that, and we know how to do that very well now thanks to Mario's technology, but we have all these puzzle pieces and we want to better understand how those genes instantiate themselves into our physiology and what those changes are. And so one way that he was trying to think about this was with imaging. And so if you look at this image, the middle image is a high-resolution micro CT scan of a normal wild-type mouse. That's an 18-day-old mouse embryo. For size, that's smaller than your little fingernail, okay? And then to the left is the knockout. There's only one gene difference between those two mice embryo. It's the PAX3 gene, which causes musculoskeletal development. You can obviously notice the difference in the skeletal development. But Mario's question to us was not just to compare these two mouse embryos. It was to take a population of the wild types and their normal variation, and a population of the knockouts with their normal variation, and then compare over space and time the changes of these populations from images. So it was, if you think about, take an image database of hundreds or thousands of images of mice or people or whatever it is, and another image database, and then how do you accurately and quantitatively compare these two sets of image databases? Well, that was an unsolved problem in computer imaging for a long time, until these three guys, who are three of my faculty, Sarang Joshi, Ross Whitaker, and Tom Fletcher, they won the David Marr Prize in imaging a few years ago by figuring out a solution to this problem. And it basically comes down to, how do you find an average image given a set of images, and then how do you make distance measurements of distances from these images to averages? And so they created some new mathematics by taking this and moving it into a nonlinear space. They found these ways, these metrics by which they could measure distances on throughout surfaces within the space. And then they came up with the statistics of shape and connectivity by which they could then say something statistically significant about an area of change, of shape change, in a database of normals versus one that had neurodegenerative or other diseases. So this has now become an amazing tool, and there's been significant interest in this by a number of research groups worldwide for using this to characterize all kinds of different changes due to shape. And one of the early successes that they had was using it to try and come up with biomarkers for neurodegenerative diseases. So current neurodegenerative diseases like autism and Alzheimer's and Parkinson's, none of them have physical biomarkers, by which I mean like a blood test you can take to say, oh, well, your parent has Alzheimer's or your child has autism. They traditionally go into a center, for example, in autism. You'll go to an autism diagnostic center where they'll do images, but they'll also give a lot of behavioral tests. And then at the end of the day, they'll add all those tests up and then, you know, put a number on a spectrum and to try and gauge that. What these guys were able to do was to do a study along with UNC and Harvard and some other universities where they had data from children, high-resolution MRI data taken soon after birth and then over months and years after birth. And then they were, a certain number of those children, most were normals, but a certain number had autism. And then they were able to go back into that data and with high accuracy predict which of the children would get autism based upon changes in part of their brain structure. And they were able to link it with some of the genetics. And so it's really exciting because it's forms the basis to start thinking about these physically based biomarkers. And while this doesn't mean there's any kind of cure for any of these diseases, but if you could diagnose someone earlier and get them into treatment earlier, then there's a chance for a much better quality of life. Okay, let me move on to some more visualization. So this is your brain. It's a simplified version. It's an abstraction of your brain, courtesy of Tor Nordtranders. And it's been partitioned up based upon the volume of your brain used for particular senses and also the speed of those senses. And so a quick glance can see that about 50% of our brains are used for visual processing. It's also the fastest part of our brain. We are very visual creatures. The next is touch, and then hearing and smell, and then there's taste. So amongst the visualization research scientists, if we can figure out a way to take this ever-growing amount of data that Homer mentioned and find visual abstractions, ways to map data to the visual portion of our brain that we can understand, that would seem to be a good and fast way to make sense of all this data. Tasting your way through lots of data, maybe not so good. Maybe more fun, but not so good. So we spend a lot of time creating new visual analysis techniques for different application problems in order to try and better understand that data, that physical phenomena, the biological phenomena. And these are some examples of visualization techniques, different visual analysis techniques in that upper left, that upper left hand corner is a visualization of the largest ever simulation of a spiral galaxy forming by Elena Dongnia, then at Harvard Smithsonian, where she had so much data that from her simulations, she couldn't visualize it. And so she sought out us, as she had heard we might be able to visualize her data, and we said, I thought we could. And the next week, I got a FedEx of multiple terabytes of data from her simulations, which we read in and used a parallel ray tracing system where each one of those billions, many billions of stars are visualized individually with the proper shading and color corresponding to the physical attributes of velocity and temperature, etc. In the middle, we have a stellar magnetism. So that's a time-dependent visualization. We're using a technique called streamlines to look at a very large simulation of magnetism of our sun. The next one in the middle, they put that in there for Homer. So Homer was part of a project we had, which had a number of very interdisciplinary project with physicists and chemists and mathematicians and mechanical engineers and computer scientists, et cetera, to do fundamental simulations of fire from first principles, and so that's a pool of jet fuel that's been set on fire, and visualizing the results from that very, very large simulation, so the big, big supercomputing simulations. More and more, we are seeing high-dimensional data that doesn't necessarily have a three-dimensional characteristic, and so we have examples here of epidemiology, spread of disease, so how can we better understand that and track that and do hypothesis testing, of molecular biology, of comparative genomics, and other examples. Okay, so let me give you some examples. We've done a lot of fundamental research in the technique and visualization called volume rendering. And volume rendering is basically to take data, image data, and to be able to figure out a way to look inside that volume of image and bring it back to a computer screen so you can better understand what's inside. And the first type of volume rendering was called maximum intensity projection. And this is a tooth, by the way, so it's an X-ray. That's a volume of a tooth where we've just gone through the volume and we found the maximum intensity along these rays that we send through the tooth, and then we pull that back. You get these kind of, well, views that look like that. There's the full version of volume rendering. Instead of just taking the maximum value, it takes all of the values along each of those rays and it adds it up in a way, and then we assign a transparency and a color to each of the pixels, and so we can have a better idea of what's going on inside. And this is a very computationally intensive algorithm, and for a long time these were, you had to have high performance computers and to be able to do this, until the advent of the NVIDIA graphics cards. And now we can do this very rapidly on even large scale systems, and so we can do even more higher resolution and larger scale systems. The work that was done by my colleagues at Utah, Chuck Hansen and Gordon Kendelman and Joe Niss, were extending this to higher dimensions. And so instead of just looking at intensity, they were able to add a higher number of ways of changing how that we looked at that rays coming back. And that gave us a way to have much more specificity in the data. So this is the same data set, same tooth, and by just changing these parameters, we could look inside in different ways. And the system is called ImageVis 3D, and it's open source software, which you can download and play with and put your own images in, and which I did with my knee and went and showed my orthopedic surgeon. And in addition to be able to do these high dimensional transfer functions, it's able to do really large scale data. So this is one of my fun examples. This is the National Institutes of Health Visible Male. He's the most famous dead guy in medical imaging. Several years ago, a little backstory. So he was a convicted murderer in Texas, and not a good place to be a convicted murderer. And before he was executed, he donated his body to science and the National Institutes of Health. And after death, he was imaged at the highest resolution of all the scanners, and then in the very end, frozen the body, put a high resolution color camera on top, took an image, and then milled a millimeter down, milled another photograph, etc. And then the NIH put all of that data online and made it available to researchers throughout the world. And he became the gold standard for human anatomy. And the data from his body that he contributed have been used in literally thousands of biomedical research papers throughout the years. From a visualization standpoint, the challenge was that the data sets were so large so high resolution that no one had the capability of visualizing them at the highest resolutions. And so what they did was they downsampled, and that's the process of basically going through your data and averaging a set of data. So if you have, you know, 8 voxels, you'll take those down to 1, etc., and you'll keep doing that. So you get a smaller data set, but it smooths out the data. So we were able to put him in our system, and because we could visualize him at the highest resolution and we add these higher dimensional transfer functions, we found out he was covered with tattoos. So this is not a photograph, This is a volume visualization of the ink in the skin, and the input data is the color photography data. So our input is a set of two-dimensional photographs all lined up, and we were looking at the data and saw some sort of pattern, we thought, and then we created a transfer function which basically pulled out all of the instances of that pattern in the volume. And you can actually see a little bit of red in the flag, and it says mom across his chest here. People had worked on this data for 10 years or more and had no idea that he was covered with tattoos because they always took the data and they downsampled it before they did anything else. And if you think about what a small scale feature ink in the skin from a tattoo is, that you won't be surprised that if you do any type of filtering that you could easily take that away from the data. And so this got us thinking about all of this big data that we're creating, where a lot of the usual steps that data analysis, data visualization people do is they automatically downsample and do dimensional reduction and filter before they even look at the data. And so you got to think about, if you have small scale features in your data, you need to think twice about doing that, and you need to do smart types of downsampling and filtering. All right. So another application of the volume rendering is work that's done by my colleague Chuck Hansen and Yong Wang at Utah. And this came about from a collaboration with biologists who were using confocal microscopy to try and better understand structure, biological structure. And the tools that they had at the time when they came to us was basically they had all of these images. They found some open source software on a website called ImageJ, and then they used Photoshop, and they had this very complicated ad hoc way of trying to go from image to the images they were getting to the visualizations they needed to better understand the structure of what they were seeing. And Chuck and his student Yong thought that volume rendering would be the way to go, and that they could actually create a much higher end system for them to get much more detail of the tool. And they've created the system called Flow Render, and it is now being used by biologists increasingly throughout the world to do some amazing stuff. So just a little video here.
Flow Render is a tool that was developed for confocal microscopy data, and it's focused on giving biologists an easy-to-use method for doing visualization and analysis of 3D confocal microscopy data. So Gabriel Cardin here at the University of Utah has found that Flow Render is a valuable tool for her research in the Cardin Lab.
The Cardin Lab works on congenital defects in muscle development, such as congenital diaphragmatic hernias. We're using it to image developing limbs and developing diaphragms, which are very complex three-dimensional structures. So I would say that we would be unable to do any of our work unless we had Flow Render.
That's the kind of feedback we like to hear from our collaborators. And the complexity of the biology and the ways in which they are able to visualize those biological structures often have yielded these beautiful images. And Yong and others who have now used this have started to enter their visualizations into these competitions. And so we now have some wins in these photography, biological or nature photography competitions, which is fun. All right. This is another example of using our system, this time for surgical planning for radiation treatment of a tumor. You'll see that there is this person, unfortunately, has a lung tumor here. And George Chen at Massachusetts General Hospital, so just down the road. The traditional way that this was done was taking images and then making a visualization and just playing it back as a single viewed video. we're able to now take this data and interact with it so he can see it interactively. And we can then use the visualization system to tag different properties of the tissue and just turn them on and off. So we can better see, for example, the structure of the tumor or its relationship to the surrounding tissues. So we can use this for both surgical planning and then the actual radiation treatment. So this is the system working on an iPhone. Mobile devices are really just taking off in use both at the level of phones and then tablets. And this is a 256 cube CT scan of a hand, and that's being entirely visualized on the iPhone using the CPU and the GPU of the iPhone. And I'm old enough to remember that it wasn't too many years ago that to be able to do this would have cost a $30,000 graphics workstation, probably an SGI workstation from Jim Clark. And now you have this in your pocket. And it's just getting better and better all the time in terms of the processing capabilities. And so we are really spending some time thinking about how these visualization algorithms can be used on these mobile devices and also for telemedicine as well. So if we can have our results that we have on a high resolution display, we can also then take them and transmit them wireless down to people with mobile devices. And one of the areas that we're working in right now, one of my colleagues, Chris Butson, is in treatment for Parkinson's disease. And this is the movement disorder that in some cases the drug treatments do not work, or they fail to work after a while, and patients do not have control over their motion, and they can't eat or drink normally. There's a fairly recent treatment which is called deep brain stimulation, where electrodes are placed deep into the brain, and then if you can stimulate them at the right place with the right voltage, they can disrupt that pattern and restore almost normal movement. So here's an example of a patient who's undergoing deep brain stimulation surgery. So you can see him shaking there. This is open brain surgery, so they're now starting to stimulate the electrodes, trying to find where is the right spot to stimulate them and with the right voltage. And what you will see is that they find the right spot. And it's kind of miraculous when you see this, that it is not a cure. If they turn off the battery, the shake comes back. But while that battery is on, he has normal control back to his movement. So where do we come in? We come in after the patient goes home and then heals, the things move around. So there's swelling that's reduced. And so they need to now re-optimize where the stimulation is in those electrodes and how much voltage should they be stimulated at. This gives you a sense, this middle image, of why they call it deep brain stimulation. These are the electrodes. And along those electrodes are a number of places where they can stimulate. And so my colleague, Chris Butson, who's a computational bioengineer, he's also a professor in neurology and neurosurgery, has used this image-based modeling approach that I talked about before and taken images of the patients, created computer models of their heads and their brains, registered where the surgeons have implanted those electrodes, and then does these simulations of every possible place that they could stimulate and at every possible voltage. And then we create a visualization system that's on an iPad given to the neurologists, so when the patient comes in, they can localize the critical structures they're looking at and in less than 5 minutes be able to optimize where the best place is to stimulate. The current state of the art is a brute force search method where the patients come in, they hook them up to a monitor, and they just start electrode one, voltage one, stimulation site one, and they watch. Voltage two, voltage three. And it takes 4 to 5 hours for them to find the right stimulation point. And so this new method with using visualization and simulation really offers a significant decrease in the amount of time to optimize these electrode stimulation site placements. So Chris has just been awarded a very large NIH grant that will allow him to do clinical trials at the major deep brain stimulation centers at Stanford and Cornell and University of Florida and other places. Okay, back to some biology. Time, good. So this is the largest ever composite image of the part of the visual cortex of the brain. And it's done by Robert Mark, who's a neuroscientist at the University of Utah, and he is part of the International Connectome Project. The Connectome Project is an international set of neuroscientists who are using mosaic electron microscopy to try and understand the fundamental wiring diagrams of our brain. And the idea is that each of these neuroscientists around the world are going to take different parts of the brain, they're going to use this technique to image it, and then they're going to try and find the track the individual neurons in that little piece, and then when everybody's done their part, they'll bring them back together and give us a full wiring diagram. Okay, so let me tell you how big this big data is. If you see these little stair steps, that's the largest, highest resolution of an electron microscope. So that's 4,096 pixels by 4,096 pixels. You should remember that your huge HDTV at home is about 2,000 by 1,000 pixels. So your TV goes in here, all right? They have this amazing technology where they take they slice the smallest pieces of brain off, image at the highest resolution of the electron microscope, dump the data. Slice, image, dump. It runs 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And when we get the data, it does not look like this. It's moved, it needs to be registered. And so my colleague Tolga Tazizan has created these tools that will register all of this data into these nice blocks. When we get one block done, one image, it's about 200,000 pixels by 200,000 pixels at a resolution of 2 nanometers per pixel, 2 × 10⁻⁹ meters per pixel. And then they do the next slice. They can't slice in the depth at nearly the resolution that they can mosaic, you know, in the XY, and so it changes a lot, even though they're trying to slice really thinly. So this makes the tracking very difficult. So you get very high resolution in the plane, but not as high resolution in the depth. When they get done with these, one of these data sets is 16.5 terabytes of data. And then they say, okay, we'd like for you to visualize this for us. And I will tell you that the fastest way for us to get this data, the highest bandwidth, is to drive our cars up to their lab, take the disks out of their computers, drive them back to our lab, and put them in. So that's the highest bandwidth. So I put Leeuwenhoek up here because Leeuwenhoek was one of the innovators of the light microscope. And he discovered a lot of new science because he could use those microscopes to see things at resolutions that no one else could. And I kind of feel like with Robert Mark's technology and with our ability to interactively visualize that 16.5 terabytes of data, that is kind of like a new microscope because that is that data set spread out over 36 30-inch monitors, so it's 41 megapixels, million pixels of resolution on there. And the neuroscientists spent hours looking at this data, and because no one had ever seen this data at this resolution, they discovered new things. They discovered by looking, they discovered by using visualization, and they wrote Science and Nature and Cell and other papers, and they were very excited about it. I will say now, the next stages of this process are twofold. One, we just submitted a proposal for the next level of technology. We now, Robert Mark's group now has a system that can create 100 terabyte data sets, and they have a path forward to 300 terabyte data sets. So we now need to figure out how do we analyze and visualize that much data. And also they now want to be able to do simulations. So they want to be able to say, well, how many of these cell types are there? Or I have a I have a theory about the electrical interaction between these cells, so I want to simulate this. And now, given the 16.5 terabyte data set, these are huge supercomputing problems from a simulation point of view, which will create more data to be able to visualize. This is just to give you a sense of the complexity of this data. So this is one cell type in that, remember, 2 nanometers per meter, how small that little piece of the brain is. And what I learned from this is we are incredibly connected beings, it is astounding. And when you start adding more and more cell types, there is just how connected the wires are within our brains. And I think the challenge for these neuroscientists is substantial if they're going to try and take different pieces and puzzle these together to find, you know, significant portions of wiring diagrams. But that's going to be a real grand challenge for the future. All right. This is not quite biological, but kind of biological. So this is data from Mark Lavoie at Stanford University multiple years ago now, where he got permission from the Academia Museum to get full access to Michelangelo's David statue and use a high-resolution laser range-finding scanner to scan the statue at sub-millimeter resolution. And we're going to zoom in there to the eye so you can see how high-resolution this is and how small those little triangles are that make up this computer model of Michelangelo's David statue. Very small. So once he did this, he gave out the data to the visualization research community and asked if anybody could actually visualize the data interactively. And we could using a parallel ray tracer, and we could also look at the data in terms of different times of the day. So that was cool. But recently, it was reconstructed at much, much higher resolution. So now it's almost a billion little triangles. And the resolution of the images you're seeing are 2 gigapixels per frame, not megapixels like your camera, but gigapixels. So we're going to zoom into that same part of the eye. And at this resolution, you're going to see chips and defects in the marble, but you can't see individual triangles. It's so high resolution data. So it's such perfect data now, the Academia Museum will not let Mark give out the data. And we are only allowed to show 4 different views, because if you had a big enough high resolution 3D printer, you could print yourself out your own Michelangelo's David statue, which is what the Academia wants to do in case. So there, it's their intellectual property, and so they are keeping that to themselves at this point. But it's just stunning data, and when you print this out on high resolution, like photography paper, and look at this at the highest resolution monitors, it just looks like it's there in 3D. And the technology is twofold. It's being able to do this parallel rendering. And I should point out, we learned that someone, MN, carved their initials in the back of one of Michelangelo's legs. I've done some research online, and I cannot figure out. They mention it, that if you go to the museum, you can see MN, but there, I can't find any information out. So if anybody knows who MN might be, I'd like to know. So it's a combination of the parallel rendering and then also the data streaming and the ability to stream that high resolution gigapixel resolution. So we have made an iPhone and iPad app, which is free, which you can download. This is called Gigapixel David, and you can get it off of iTunes. You'll notice it had to be rated 17 plus, so you can only get it's the world we live in. You can go see those 4 images that we're allowed to show you at the highest resolution. It's really remarkable, because you can zoom in just like I was doing up here on your iPhone or your iPad, and really see things at that resolution. So I encourage you to do that. All right, let's see, how am I doing on time? I'm actually gonna skip this and go for this one. So this is my young colleague, Mariah Meyer. She's a star in the field of information visualization. where the idea is to look at patterns and correlations within data, underlying meaning, and of data that doesn't necessarily have a three-dimensional spatial scientific medical component like you've seen. One of the things that distinguishes her from many of her other colleagues is the way she works is that instead of trying to find a one-size-fits-all package where you have to kind of change your data somehow and get it into and hopefully find a way to work it, she actually really targets and does close collaboration with the scientists she worked with. So in this case, she was working with people at the Broad Institute between Harvard and MIT, and she embedded herself in one of the labs of a comparative genomicist, read the papers, interviewed the scientist, evaluated the current visualization tools to find out what worked and what didn't, and then she would go away and design and prototype a new system that she thought would solve their particular biological problem better. Give it to them, let them use it, get feedback on it, go design a better version. And it was this iterative prototyping effect until over months of time, she had a system that actually did solve that problem better. And here's an example of four of those systems that she's designed, and they look different because they solve four different problems. I'll tell you one example. This is some work with a comparative genomicist who was comparing the genetics of people, which is the outer ring, with different mammalian species. And he had come up with a model that that would predict the relationship between certain chromosomes of human with these different mammalian species. And this is the first time he looked at the data in Mariah's visualization tool. And these broad green and red bands here are correct. Everything else is wrong. So he immediately knew that his theory and model was wrong. So he went back to the drawing board, came back at it. This was a improved model, but after seeing this, he decided that he had something fundamentally wrong with his model. So he went away for a long time and used Mariah's tool and successfully experimented with the new models over time until he came up with this solution, which was the experimentally verified and then published model. And Mariah asked him how long he thought it would have taken to get to this point without her visualization system, and he said, quite frankly, I don't think I ever would have gotten there. And so it's such a great example of two scientists working together where neither could have solved the problem by themselves, and by only working together, they could solve this problem. And the power of visualization to help a scientist, in this case a biologist, a comparative biologist, be able to come up with a solution that he wouldn't have otherwise been able to come up. And I do want to note that you've seen just these static images, but the real power of Mariah's tools are their interaction. And so this, hopefully I hit that and it will play. Maybe I didn't, let's try again. A little short clip that shows, there we go, of Mariah's system in action. And so the biologists would literally spend hours a day with their data and with their hypothesis and looking at this and getting feedback and then tuning and their models and trying out new hypothesis, you know, and there too an iterative system until they came up with the final theory. All right, well, I am getting to the end of my time here, so let me show you the smiling faces of the Ski Institute faculty, staff, and students. We're about 200 total, and I've shown you some of just a small amount of the work that we do there, so I do hope you will go to the website there and check out more work. These are our productivity machines we have at the Institute. We have 5 espresso machines in case 4 break down, and so those are absolutely necessary. And we have a ping pong table in that's our reception area. You can see the elevator over there. Because we found out that ping pong was the international nerd sport where computer scientists and other scientists from all over the world, they may not play football or baseball or lacrosse, but they all play ping pong. And so we have institute championships and et cetera. Anyway, well, I thank you very much for your time. I am happy to answer any questions that anybody has. Yes?
So in light of the ICERM mission about bridging the relationship between the mathematics and computing, I'm asking, have you been involved in projects where you use great tools like this to visualize and do an active mathematical objects?
Yes, yeah, as a matter of fact. And I will say that the computer science parts of what we're doing have increasingly become more mathematical. So we have two faculty who are quote-unquote visualization faculty, but they do topological data analysis, and they spend a huge amount of time thinking about topological and geometrical spaces, and they do more SMAIL complex theory and apply, take applications in mathematics or theory, and then try to find ways that they can use that in data analysis and visualization. And some of those visualization techniques that they have come up with have now been taken back to help them create new mathematics. And so there are collaborations with our mathematics colleagues where they write papers that go into, you know, math journals that have been inspired by some of the work that they've done on the visualization research side. So there's an ever more integrative and interactive collaboration between within mathematics and within the computer science. And we see this too with the work in artificial intelligence and deep learning. It's just getting to such a point where they need much more mathematics in order to understand how the complexity of some of these deep learning algorithms are actually working. So I see, and the image analysis, and it's because the shape analysis, for example, is, you know, they created new mathematics to be able to solve that problem of the image-based phenotyping.
So are you taking in data from your sensors or from data set that you've acquired in some way and putting mathematical structure on it? There are also mathematical structures that are defined through equations and relationships and things like that that we really love to visualize and play with. Mathematicians tend not to have.
That's true, and that would be interesting to do. We've started to do a little bit with like software visualization. That's another side on the computer science that they rarely use. They have very, very primitive tools to look at algorithm design and software implementation, and especially how when the software systems get really, really complex. And so we've done a little bit of work in that area, but it'd be fun to also go the other way with the mathematicians. Yeah, interesting idea. Other questions for me? I think they all want to go to dinner.
Well, if there are no other questions, shall we thank Chris again?
Thanks.